Blackstone presents In Emergency, Break Glass: What Nietzsche Can Teach Us About Joyful Living in a Tech-Saturated World by Nate Anderson. This book is read by Rick Adamson. For Gordon. 1. Burn the boats. The Tiger's Eye. My life shrank slowly, until one day it became too small. I used to feel that in stitching me together, the universe had rather gone out of its way. To know that my atomic makeup was forged in the furnaces of the primal starfield, and that my childhood geography was shaped by glaciers dragging themselves north through Wisconsin for centuries, well, it all suggested a lot of effort. I felt a duty to make that work count, to change history for the better, to bestride the narrow world like a colossus, or at least to do more than watch epic amounts of television. Under the influence of the 1980s band Survivor, I adopted the Eye of the Tiger. I would change the world, and I'd enjoy doing it. Yet one day, I woke to find that carpe diem had been replaced by how many emails can I answer before noon? It happened so gradually. When at last I noticed, I looked around with a shock to find that my life had taken on a certain indoor quality, comfortable but quiet and air-conditioned. Perhaps it was just a case of becoming a realist with a mortgage, but it felt more deflating. Technology did not cause this lifestyle contraction, but it served as means and enabler. I was the product of a revolution in communication, media, and practically everything else that had driven us all indoors during the past century. Even in a friendly Midwestern town of immaculate houses, I didn't meet my neighbor for 3 years. Our encounter required another intervention of the universe, a freak blizzard that drew us all outside to clear several feet of snow from our driveways. My neighbor had until then existed for me as a head inside a Lexus, but he now burst forth in triumph from his garage, astride the largest yellow snowblower I have ever seen. The winter's disruption sparked some dormant sense of community, and my neighbor offered to clear my drive. But we spoke only for a moment. The snarl of the machine prevented further connection. I went back inside, pleased with the help, but wondering if life might not be better had I shoveled alongside my neighbor in amiable conversation for an hour. The internet allowed me to write from home, and I made a fair living as a technology journalist whose commute could be as short as sitting up in bed to crack open the laptop. There was peace and freedom in this, and there was limitation. It required effort to make new friends. It required effort simply to escape the house. After a decade working from home, my days were spent before computers, my nights spent before televisions, and my free moments spent itching to unlock a tablet or mobile phone. My grandparents had farmed the fertile fields of Iowa, slaughtered hogs, and sold Ethan Allen furniture. They lived into their 90s without ever watching more than Wheel of Fortune and the evening news. They had little need for screens, yet my life had become screens. Without them, I could no longer read the paper, write a letter, play a game, talk to friends, work a job, check the weather, make a to-do list, read a novel, listen to music, watch a movie, or take a photograph. The world's tactile richness was reduced to polished pieces of glass. Atoms, galaxies, the universe is ever restless. Yet there I was, day after comfortable day, sitting still. I sat on couches, beds, and chairs. Some days I mixed things up by moving from the couch in the basement to the couch in the living room, or from the chair at my desk to the chair in my bedroom. I became a champion seat sitter. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.